Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all of our participants around the world. Thank you for taking the time from your busy schedule to be here for this session. I'm Sajia Mehjabeen, Nutrition Advisor at Concern Worldwide, and I'll be facilitating this exciting session that will highlight the current state of the scale-up, severe wasting services in Somalia and South Sudan.
We are here, you're loud and clear.
And also, we will find out some key barriers and enablers for this process. To present the country case studies, we have with us today a representative from Somalia Ministry of Health, Farhan Mohamed Mohamed. He's the head of nutrition section in the Federal Ministry of Health in Somalia. And we also have with us Bishar Usman Hussein from Concern Worldwide. He is the Health and Nutrition Program Manager for Somalia. From South Sudan, we have Ministry of Health. We have us with Khamisa Ayoub. She's a nutritionist and is acting director of the nutrition department for the National Ministry of Health in South Sudan. And we also have with us Lubaba Hussein. She's the nutrition technical coordinator and partnership focal point for Concern Worldwide. So we will start the presentation in a couple of minutes, but before that, just a couple of few points. Just remember that if you have any question during the presentation, please post those questions in the question and answer box, and we will have a short session just after the presentation, and we will get back to your questions. If there is any technical difficulties, please make sure to post your queries on the chat box, and one of our team members will try to resolve that as soon as possible. So, as you know, that we are facing many technical difficulties, and we made sure that we pre-recorded both of the sessions. So, that if something happens, you will be guided to access the recorded version. We might have some difficulties with the South Sudan presentation because we are facing some issues over there. If we are not able to go for the presentation for South Sudan, we will direct you to the recorded version. So it's a very packed day ahead, and I am sure you are all very excited to hear from the presenter. So let's go straight into the presentation from Somalia, Farhan Mohamed and Bishar. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Sadia, and good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. My name is Bishar Usman, as already briefed. Introduced by Sajia. I will be taking with you the case study for Somalia, and I will focus on particularly the area of wasting services. And next slide, Sajia, please. And in Somalia, the Western Garden is significant, as you can see. The map on the left side across the country.
Just Bishar, 1 minute. Khamisa, can you please mute your microphone, please?
You can close this one for a little bit.
Khamisa, can you please mute? Yes, Bishar, go ahead. Sorry for that.
Yeah, sorry, no problem. As you can see, the map on the left side is recent survey conducted by FSPU, and unusually it's predicted about the nutrition pattern across the country. So you'll find out across the country there is a huge prevalence of malnutrition, and that prompts the need for some CMAM scale up. And having mentioned the burden of malnutrition across the country, there was significant progress made for the last years. For example, the coverage for wasting, though it fluctuates across the years, but there has been significant improvement and shows above 100. And global wasting prevalence remains a higher threshold. And also the same as the Sapir standard maintained and across the Sapir recovery and also moderate recovery in 95 and 92. Second slide. some of the key successes in scaling up of the nutrition, the CMAM in Somalia. One is the strengthening of the health and nutrition governance structure in the country at national level and regional level, as well as district level. There is a significant improvement on that, and that has significantly contributed the achievement of the CMAM coverage success. Second is the coordination improvement. Previously, most of the nutrition coordinations used to happen at outside the country, particularly Nairobi, but recently it was moved to Mogadishu, becoming closer to the operations, and afterwards it was decentralized across the country, whereby regions, districts are now having regular coordination meetings, which was not there. We attribute this as one of the key pillar among the success, the key success. Community engagement was another layer of and moving forward with the CMAM and Western management improvement. And site distributions was one of the key things whereby the MOH and the nutrition partner were able to have proper site distribution among the services in terms of the CMAM coverage. And across the country, there were also maintained supply pipelines in several hubs where in supplies of the year were available, and partners were able to access those supplies. And not only the nutrition aspect, but also what has contributed the key success include the integration of the health and nutrition and hygiene promotion programming in program sites was also one of the key success that has significantly contributed to the achievement of the past years. And next, please. And among the enablers and the barriers in the country, majority of the nutrition services rely on humanitarian agencies, and across the country, and the nutrition partners currently operating in the country, according to the cluster, there are around 78 organizations, and approximately 70% of them are providing integrated nutrition services. We are referring nutrition services the whole component of the CMAM services. And the other enabler things that significantly allowed to succeed the CMAM interventions in relation to the response of the Western management is the decentralization mechanism for coordinations aspects, and also in the leadership role for the MOH in terms of and programmings, and also moving from vertical programming to integrated versions. And among the key things that also supported the achievement and the enablers include, and particularly, the sustainable supply pipelines for poultry in most parts of the country. Luckily, for the last 2 years, 3 to 4 years, there was no significant outbreaks reported. It was also another milestone helped the CMAM and success in the country, and community awareness and engagement was another key in aspects. More importantly, the robust awareness partners and the MOH and nutrition unit department led also was a key success to enable a proper enabler for this. And among the barrier, there are many barrier things, but we are going to highlight here very few ones. Among the key one is a mixture of services, and the service provider are a number of humanitarian agencies. It's not 100% now relying on the MOH, so it's one of the barrier. And the rollout was not very much deficient in terms of PHS in the country. It was revised recently, but it was not completely now rolled out. And there is significant socioeconomic status among the populations in IDPs and also the rural, particularly the long state IDPs was also another issue. Recurrent drought and prolonged conflict was also significantly contributing among the barriers. There was also, in terms of the team SAM management, there was significant improvement, as I've mentioned in my previous slides, in terms of the coverage, but still we have gaps in terms of the MAM due to nutrition commodities and availability, not very much sufficient across the country. Funding constraint is also another layer and just hindering us to achieve the well and scale up. And low coverage of same services, MAM services in some parts of the country is also a challenging. This is a very key issue. All those children who are currently maybe MAM will wait and then they will fall into SAM. Then this will increase the burden of the SAM load. And in terms of all those challenges and difficulties and also the success, there were also innovations and also in innovatives to promote on those aspects. So one of them include like MWAC family adaptations, which we have also recently adapted in our programmings. Why we have adapted? One of the things, this is just to improve early detections and referrals at community level. And this is started prior to the pandemic. It was not something just start. And also one of the advantage for the MWAC adaptation is that it increased timely coverage for the beneficiaries to attend the facilities, and also some sort of demand creation for those who are not aware of the service availability. What will be the next in terms of the MWAC adaptation is that the MOH is thinking to adapt and to incorporate the national protocol and standardized trainings. The other adaptation is modified admission criteria. And this was adapted because of the COVID era. And there was a lot of limitation because of the COVID in situation. And for the time being, the admission, the modified admission criteria is used across all sites and will be used till further notice. There's also expanded criteria, which we also use it, especially in areas where there's no MAM services. Integration of multi-sectoral programming was another recently adapted approach, especially addressing underlying nutrition and sensitive aspects. Cash is in nutrition programming is also another key layer, which we feel that it will have significant and support to or address the underlying conditions. And cash transfer to families, particularly of some children, to prevent relapses and also a long stay in of the program. Next. And the other, Sajia, you jump it over, please. Can you come back?
Okay. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, I skipped one slide.
Yeah. The other is the single combined protocol, modified RASV dosage because of the COVID adaptations, all weight for height. Other measurements were suspended except in MWAC, and also the dosage was standardized for all children just to minimize the contacts and reduce social gatherings and crowds. These are all sites, and we maintain till further notice. What will be the next will to see the outcome indicators to assess the impact of this action. The other important thing is that the ICC M Plus is an approach that and recently adopted, not all organizations and across the country, but few organizations and adopted. One of the reasons is just to decentralize the treatment sites to increase service coverage. Secondly, is just the piloting to scale up is also in the process. Next will be the scaling up approach, but this will depend on the interests of the MOHs and also available resources, and also and to integrate into the community health manual, the national community health manual. Second, and the CMAM search, and recently we are going to adapt, and why we propose this is that it helps to anticipate and predict the caseloads for better planning and manage spikes during demand. The plan is just a pilot and part of ECHO-funded AFMAD Blast Consortium. Next, we are waiting the approvals. And the other key important for our recent adaptation is IYCFE adaptations and in emergency adaptations. And recently, we were able to present at the global conference and has been invited to submit a manuscript for publishing on our IYCF adaptations in emergence, which is under review now. And commitment for moving to forward for the scale up, one of the things is that and one of the commitment is just to support the MOH in terms of the steward and also service to providers. This support will be in supporting the DMOs, the district health management teams, regional health management teams, so they will have the ownership and the leadership of the implementations, and in future that will maintain the sustainability. The other important is the integration of the nutrition and health, and support the revised EBHS and rollouts. The EBHS was revised recently, but now it's under endorsement. The other commitment taking forward is that the standardization and the standardization of community health cadres among the to bring the curative services to community level. That's also another key important, and will take part in the case management. The other key issue is the piloting of Imam Surge, which will anticipate, prepare for, and deliver services. Some of the recent innovations is to incorporation of the learnings from the nutrition research conducted in the country, those innovations to down what we have learned and better plan for future improvement. And Tati, I will give the last slide to Farhan to present. So,
okay. Yeah. Over.
Thank you very much again, Sajia and the other colleagues. Just briefly, I will continue to explain the last slide I'm presenting. I think this is how we can sensitize and emphasize the nutrition program and other sensitive. So, nutrition is a multi-sectoral approaches, and so we can to prevent and reduce the malnutrition rates in the country. We have to focus and improve and emphasize the other sectors like the wash, sanitation and hygiene, food security. So it will have that impact to prevention and reduction of the malnutrition rates across the country. The other one is a consortia approach providing. This is also is part of the effort is needed to have harmonized services for the nutrition. So other sectors will be combined to have good services for the nutrition at district level. Also, it will have a direct impact to the prevention and detection of malnutrition. It's a complementarity approach. The other thing is that the technical capacity support, Minister of Health, personnel needs to have to improve the capacity of the Minister of Health personnel, specialists, the nutrition staff, we needed to have a capacity building for them, at least to increase the surface qualities and giving it to the people for quality surface for the nutrition interventionists in the country. The other one is funding for the Minister of Health staff, especially the nutrition, to at least retain the qualified personnel in the Minister of Health to cover for their incentive top-ups, other necessary support they need, like operation costs, other things. This is also will have a good thing to have that funding from the donors to increase the HR incentives in the Ministry of Health. And this is what we have presented today. Again, thank you very much for your having me this opportunity.
Thank you so much, Farhan and Bishar, for your excellent presentation. And especially, like, I was really, like, it was encouraging to see that despite all the challenges, you have made sure to adapt the program to continue services during the COVID-19 context. So it's kind of really, really encouraging and promising practice for all of the countries who are still struggling to continue services. So I'll just try to see if we can get connect to our South Sudan colleagues. And Khamisa, can you hear us?
Yes, you're loud and clear now.
Perfect, perfect. What I'll do is, like, I will share the presentation for you, and I will, yeah, you can just present it, okay? Is it okay?
Yeah, it's okay, we'll do that.
There's a little bit of a delay, but I think we will be able to get through it. So we don't have much time, so let's just go straight to the presentation. Let me just try to open it. Okay. Can you see it? Can you see the presentation? Khamisa?
Yes, we are. Yes.
I think we have 15 minutes to present this. Clear. So if there's a lag in responses, we might need to go to the pre-recorded session, but let's just give it a try. Let's see. Khamisa, you want to start now? Yeah, I don't think it's going to work, actually.
Let me start. Yeah, good morning, evening, good afternoon to everybody. Thank you very much, Ziga, for introduction, and we are really very sorry for what happened yesterday and today, but we hope things will be well. To start with, I think from South Sudan, I'm going to take you through the case study done in South Sudan. We will start with an overview of nutrition situation in South Sudan. As we can see from the screen, we have the global acute malnutrition rate in South Sudan is 16.2%, which is above the 15% of WHO emergency. And also we have projected the children, about 1.4 million children in 2021 will be acutely malnourished. And among these, we have 1.1 million mom cases, and then we have 313,000 some cases. And also we project about 52.6% of our county will experience the crisis or emergency. Most of them will be in phase three and phase four. And then if we see also the children under 2 years during the assessment, the last assessment done, we have the number of 93 children, 93% of the children under 2 years are not meeting, receiving their minimum acceptable diet. And also to continue with the situation, I think we have 38.3 million of under five reported ill. I think these 2 points are contributing for the worsening situation in South Sudan. Further, and if we compare the situation from 2019 up to 2020-21, we will see the faces according to IPC analysis. 12 of our county out of this 18 county will experience emergency, and 30 will experience crisis. And for 2020 January up to April, 20 county were in emergency, and then 28 facing crisis. So if we follow from 2019 up to this moment currently, we can see the situation is very clear. We have 29 county are in emergency, and then 24 county are in crisis. So this is a clear situation that our situation is not going well. Although we have the situation, go ahead, move. Yes, and the situation of wasting and stunting in the country, if we compare 2010-2019, we can see in 2010 the situation was worse, very high number of wasting in the country, and this reduced in 2018, because during that period we start to roll out the guidance of nutrition in the country. But in 2019 also the number increased. That's why I say the situation is deteriorating more. And also if we see the some cases managing is scaling in the country, if we follow from 2014 to 2019, it is very clear the situation was improving, because a lot have been done to increase the coverage and then the admission rate in the country. If we see from 2014, the admission rate is very, very low compared to the burden of human nutrition in the country. And I want to concentrate in 2016-2017. This is where I think our country is start to harmonize the guideline, and then everybody is doing the same guideline of CMAM guideline we introduced during that time. And this one really lead to increase the admission rate if we compare to the target we put for during that time. And if we see in 2020, the number decreased from the previous year, 2019, because during this period, I think the admission criteria changed because of COVID-19. And also the contributing factor for this, we increased the number of sites. We increased the number of the sites of SAM program. Please, you go back. We increased the site, and then we also increased the admission rate, and also the cure rate is very good compared to the previous years. Move. As we are doing some, also we are doing, we are scaling with MAM cases. And the situation was the same, because after implementation of the guideline, I think the situation improved. We can see from the graph 2014 compared to 2020. This is also because a lot have been done. And then also we increase the number of the site. This also increased the coverage to our country. Mm-hmm. Yeah, as well we do for under five, MAM and SAM, we have also doing the MAM for pregnant and lactating to make sure our children has got the window of opportunity of 1,000 days. This is why we are managing as well the pregnant lactating. We can see the admission from 2014 compared to 2019 to 2020. I think the number is increased very fast, and even the COVID-19 did not affect the admission rate of a pregnant lactating, because we are using from beginning the MUAC to admit the children to pregnant lactating in the program. More. And for this success, I think we have a lot, as I mentioned before briefly. We have one nutrition national guideline, one protocol for continuum of care. For all, we don't mix the guideline, only one guide for all. And we have a joint scaling up plan with our partners. We are working together, we plan together. And then also the harmonization of nutrition implementing partners. Because before, maybe five or three partners will work in one county, but now we divide it. Any partner can work in one county. If the county is very big, we divide the county into two or three according to the largeness of the county. And then also we have the scaling up of community outreach. Yeah, those hard to reach area, I think we have mobile services, or we have a standalone nutrition program for them in weekly basis or bi-weekly basis. And then also we have access to hard to reach area. During the security or main natural disaster like flooding currently taking place, I think we have ready team, RRM team, they are managing that situation. And also the uses of expanded criteria, sometimes because of we have challenges of this supply, so we use the expanded criteria. When there is no other supply in place, we use another one to cover. And also the integrated program. Within nutrition is not a, nutrition is a cross-cutting issue. So integration of it, although it's not fully, but we integrate nutrition with health, wash, food security, and then gender-based violence activity. Mm-hmm. Okay, instead of integration for wasting into the health facility, I think we in the South Sudan, we have a national health policy, and then also we have package for a basic package for health and nutrition services. This package, this document is really supporting integration of wasting service into the health facility. However, we can see because of instability in the country, most of nutrition activity is done by NGO. And the NGO sometimes also when in, during their work, they are facing the challenges, but if we have one partner doing nutrition at the same time they are doing health, the integration level was very good. But sometimes we find for the health is a different partner, and then for nutrition is a different partner. And also the nutrition supply chain is still funded and operated by UN agency, because as I mentioned from the beginning, still we are not stable to handle this thing, but in the process in the future, I think we will manage. But UN agency, they are doing well, UNICEF and WFP, they are managing the supply for nutrition. Although sometimes there is challenges, but still they are doing very far. And financing by donor and UN agency for nutrition program is there in place. Mm-hmm. We have Ebola's and the supporting the wasting service in the country. As I said, we have partners still taking lead for for nutrition service in the country. We have very strong coordination mechanism among nutrition stakeholders, like a nutrition cluster team, UN and government, and implementing partners. We are doing at the national level, we are doing very well. We have a good coordination. We are managing nutrition situation. And existing health infrastructure. We have health infrastructure in the country. Is helping us to map the nutrition site, or how we can provide nutrition service through this health infrastructure. And availability of donor funding, UN and UN agency and IPs, I think it is a very good and a very good opportunity, because the work and the service is going on. And then reliable supply management with our UN agency in the country. I think this is very, very healthy to ensure the availability of the supply in the country. And the action to capitalize this enablers, I think we have a strong coordination at the national level. We need to take it to at the state level or sub-national level. If they are also strong enough, I think in the future we are not going to face any problem. And advocacy for nutrition strategy and finalization of policy. Yeah, we don't have very strong nutrition strategy at the government level. And at the same time also, we need to finalize the policy, nutrition policy. We have nutrition policy, but remained draft since 2009. And need for continuation of peace and security. Yeah, although now we are feeling the peace, but still there are some counties or some of the villages that are still experiencing insecurity. But we need to continue with the peace now we are feeling to all citizens of South Sudan. Advocacy for funding through the government system too, because most of the funding is coming through our partners or UN and donor. But we need to have the system also. The government must have this funding. The donor must have the funding through also the government system. Move ahead. Next. Yeah, we have barriers affecting the system in service delivering, lack of a strategic plan, and NGO operating as a service delivery. And we have this, we said the service is a life-saving, but we need also the developmental activity to be in place. Insecurity and conflict, limited human resource budget for nutrition services, and staff turning over from the government and NGO. This also affects the service. Poor infrastructure and limited access and availability of non-functional health facility due to insecurity. Also, you will see that there is people in that area, but due to insecurity, our partners sometimes will move away because of insecurity or inaccessibility. The action to address this barrier, I think we need to update the basic package for health and nutrition, and then a strategic plan to ensure technical correct, because the basic package for health and nutrition is not mentioned nutrition agenda very clear. So we need to update and to make sure nutrition is visible in that package. Scaling up integration response and improve nutrition outcome. Advocates for resource allocation and strengthening of the government accountability framework and supply, like a supply chain, financial, and then program implementation. More. Next slide. Okay. Recent adaptation to wasting service. I think due to this COVID-19, we have modified admission criteria Why we do that? Because we want to limit the contact and to all our country. And the next, we want to continue review and update adaptation based. Yeah, based on based on situations. Yeah, based on situation. And also we promote the family more. Yeah, to because due to suspension of active screening, and this is for the whole country, we need to continue also promoting the approach and observe the situation more. And remote monitoring and supervision, because we want to limit the contact during the field visit to all our county, and then we will continue monitoring the situation until if the COVID-19 is over, we will come back to our guideline, normal guideline. And we suspend also suspension of household survey because we want to prevent the transmission across the country. And then also we adaptation of our assessment methodology, because now we have a methodology like a global guidance in household survey. More? Yeah, the commitment. As a government, our commitment, we need to continue with rolling out national guidelines, nutrition guidelines in the country, and then fully assign nutrition department at all level of the Ministry of Health structure. Because now we can see we don't have single nutrition personnel at the health facility level, and some county also missing, and then there is no good structure of a nutrition department in the state and then the county. We are working for that to improve. And then what is lacking, I think we lack multi-sectorial cost strategy and update of our nutrition policy, domestic resources mobilization and nutrition agenda. And also we need nutrition curriculum, because in the country we don't have good human resource, trained human resource. Those who are trained from outside, their number is few, and then some are trained within. But everyone is, every institution has its own curriculum, so we need the national one. Lack of domestic household health survey, the last one was 2010, which is old. And then during that time, most of our people, they are in diaspora. But now, compared to this situation, it's not matching. And then we need peace and good governance. We have more. Yeah, our way forward, we are looking forward to strengthening the prevention. And this graph will show us how we need our wasting service to be. Because now we can see most of this service is within the health facility. We need the TLV, Boomer Health Initiative, community health worker to build very strong relationship. Network at the community level to help in referring system and following the defaulters. And at the same time, we need also some activity to support our community, because like a homegrown school garden, and then also we need nutritional program to be within the community, near to the community, to help our people. And also we need a digital tracking system for monitoring nutrition activity. Now we start with a CODA supported by WP. I think we start well at the facility level, but we need to move up to the community level. Thank you very much. And I'm really very sorry for internet connection. This is our problem in South Sudan. You can see from here. Thank you very much, Sajia.
Thank you so much, Khamisa. That was excellent presentation. Actually, you very well summarized all the barriers and enablers of scaling up treatment services in South Sudan, and it was really comprehensive. So just looking at the time, I think we will go straight into our Q&A session. Okay, so the first question was from Kate Golden, and the question is for both South Sudan and Somalia. So she wanted to know if the supply of more tape was any issue in South Sudan. So if Farhan, you want to go, Bishar, Farhan, or Khamisa? Hello? Can you hear me, Khamisa? Okay, I'll just go to Somalia then. Bishar, yeah.
From this question, Hattie, thank you very much for this question. Yeah, I hear you loud and clear. You are not hearing me?
So Kate wanted...
Hello?
Yes. Kate wanted to know... Yes. Hello?
I'm hearing you loud and clear. You are not getting me.
Yes, there's a little bit of delay. So the question is, has supply of Moab been an issue for your country to scale up family Moab? Khamisa, we are having a little bit of delay, so I'll just go to Somalia. Shar Farhan, if you want to answer this question.
Yeah, the human resource and then also the facility level and within the community level. Yeah.
Okay. I will try to take question for Somalia first because I think there's some issue. And a little bit of delay. So there was a question from Suzanne about, with regards to cash programming for nutrition outcomes, particularly for targeting of households with some children with delayed recovery or relapse, how do they ensure the risk of food factors and course the incentives that they may provide to caregivers?
Thank you very much, Sashia. That's a very good question. I hope you can hear me well.
Yes, you're clear.
Please confirm. Okay, thank you very much. And this very key question, and in relation to the answer of this question, and there are a number of steps, a number of measures we put in place to ensure that this works well. For example, there's a close interaction between the nutrition and providing agencies in that area and the program. There's significant involvement of community health workers who will follow up to those families, ensure the specific children who are malnourished receive these cash recipients, and there's a continuous monitoring of the nutritional status. They also link up to those children to the health centers and to have follow-ups and regular checkups. Mothers and caretakers who are involved to this cash programming, they are also part of the caretakers at the center where they receive the counseling and the group promotions. And more importantly, there's a regular BDM exercise periodically and conducted whereby actions that come out any of these that are addressed in the subsequent visits. There's also community involvement in terms of the community health committees established in the targeted locations. And also there's also some documentations whereby the growth monitoring of those children are monitored at the facilities, and routinely they are linked up with the community-based and community health workers. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bishar. So the next sets of questions were from South Sudan, but if we cannot, if the connection is bad, really bad, then we will go back to Somalia again. So South Sudan, the next question was, do you think that CHW treating wasting in the community could help improve the coverage? And also, do you think that the CHWs are ready in South Sudan to take in the treatment aspect?
Okay, this is a very good question. This issue of homework, I think it is a problem. But if you compare the infection of COVID-19 and then the COVID-19 and the situation which is going on, is still we are pushing, because this thing come without, we are not ready for it. And then the supply of homework is a problem. And even as I say, we have a human resource, is also a problem. But now what we are doing, we start to train the community health workers or nutrition volunteer to go to the community to train the mother. But it still is a challenge for us using the MWAC because it prevents most of the children during the normal or standard protocol, they are entered through ways for high. But now we are using only MWAC and we are missing a lot of them, a lot of children in the program. And then from the box also, I can see the issue of the human resource. Yes, government have a plan. So we start at the national level. We will go to the state level, and then later on, we will see the community up to health facility. The problem, the idea is there, but you know, we are not stable up to now, but we are trying our level best to have the clear human resource to cover nutrition services and then to free the challenges.
Thank you, Khamisa. So the next question is also for you. So what would you say about the integration of nutrition into health programming in terms of funding and operation? For example, in consideration of the health food fund, what's your plan?
I can say now we start through the partners who are working under the health food fund, they start the integration. But up to now, as in my presentation, I say, if we have two partners are working in health in one health facility, and they are working parallel, so there is a plan to have a full integration. Now we are trying to develop even the guidance, the full integration can be visible in the country. Due to funding, we have a challenges because most of this funding are going through the UN agency and our partners. Now we are trying to establish the good system of on resource mobilization, domestic resource mobilization to address this issue. Because up to now we cannot say only we plan. And then our partners is taking the lead. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Khamisa. And we are really grateful. I can see the time is up. And also, we don't have any more questions to start. But the participants, if you have any questions, please feel free to go to the discussion page or post it there. So we will be able to answer it later. I'm really grateful for the time and effort of both South Sudan and the Somalia team to share your thoughts and experience with us today. With this, I'm just going to end the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for your support.
Thank you very much, Sajia.
Thank you. Thank you.